Welcome to Skippy Low Looks at Hollywood. Tonight's guests are motion picture star Aldo Ray and former wife of famous mystery writer Mickey Spillane, Sherry Spillane. And now, here's your man of the half hour, Skippy Low.
Ray, tell me quickly. Harry Cohn.
Yes.
Discovered you. Brought you to Hollywood?
Well, he didn't bring, not him, you know, it was actually David Miller, the director, that was the one that really picked me out of the group in San Francisco, out of several hundred athletes, and he took me to Hollywood, and he nursed me through Saturday's Hero, the football film.
Mm-hmm. That was your first film?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then Harry Cohn, apparently, he kept getting the word on, who's this guy with the voice, this guy in this picture?
Whatever.
It used to, you know, it really was different than it is now. It's richer now.
Yeah. It used to be more like this.
Yeah,
you know, people still say, you know, they ask me, what happened to your voice?
I say, it got better.
You know the movie I love? I love Rita Hayworth.
Well, Miss Sadie Thompson.
Sadie Thompson, yeah.
We had a ball doing that. We shot it in Kauai, you know.
Uh-huh.
Over there, and we were there for 20-some-odd days.
And was she fun to work with?
Yeah, Rita was a real lovely lady.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, you know, I guess some of those lovely ladies always get involved in bad romances. She was shacked up with Dick Hames at the time.
Shack up?
Yeah.
Well, okay.
Yeah,
you know, they weren't married.
Yeah, okay. And Jose Ferrer and me begged her, never don't marry Dick Hames. He's out for your dough.
Was he?
Yeah, he was. Yeah, he married her, she paid her his bills, and they got divorced.
Okay.
Yeah, honest to God.
I love it.
And Ferrer and me begged her. We just told her, don't marry this guy, for Christ's sake. You know.
You didn't like him, huh?
No. I didn't. I didn't dislike him. It was just, you know, just nothing to me. You know, nothing and a nobody to me. You know, what the hell?
Judy Holliday.
Yeah, Judy, beautiful
wonderful
lady.
Movie, The Marrying Kind.
Yeah, that was great. That was 51 we did that.
51?
51.
And lady was she? I loved her.
She was a beautiful lady, you know, real earthy girl, you know. She, the first time I ever heard a woman, you know, tell it like it is, she said, tell those guys to go boom themselves.
She cursed.
I said, what? She said, you heard me? I said, I was from a little town in Northern California, and she tells these guys to go F themselves, you know. I said,
you're Italian, aren't you?
Yes.
Galliano. What's your last name again?
Dare. Yeah, anglicize it as Dare. Dare.
Dare.
Yeah, we're Venetian. My people are Venetian.
Your mother is 81, and I understand, plays bingo.
Every night of the week. Oh, yeah, she goes bingo, bingo, bingo. New Year's Eve.
Even now, 81?
This last New Year's Eve, 1987.
Right.
She was out till 4 in the morning playing bingo.
I love it.
Days later, she was out till 1 in the morning. I came into the house at about 11:30, and I didn't see her bingo paraphernalia in the living room. And I said, geez, I wonder if Mom's still out or she took it to bed with her, you know, to the bedroom. I said, well, my brother had left the lights on, the porch lights on, and I said, she must be out. Uh-huh. I went to bed. She came in at 1 o'clock.
Uh-huh. What's new and exciting in Aldo Ray's life now? I understand you'll be going to Africa to do a film?
South Africa, yeah.
South Africa?
Yeah.
You're going to be doing a
picture called Pop's Oasis. Uh-huh. It's an interesting thing about it is the actual story takes place between Las Vegas and Los Angeles.
Why go all the way
to Africa? We have to go to Africa to get the money out. See, you can't take cash out, so they have to make the film there and take the film out.
Isn't that strange?
You know, one of those, you know, financial situations. And they're going to put up signs, you know, Las Vegas. It's supposed to be an offbeat road between L.A. and Vegas. And we come into this little town, which is, the whole town is Pop's Oasis.
It's
a gas station with a garage and they're playing cards there, and there's a bar and a restaurant. I guess they might serve a hamburger or a hot dog or something. And it's a real redneck situation.
I see.
A justice of the peace and a sheriff a couple other guys.
I see Porky's in the film.
Chuck Mitchell. Chuck, I understand he plays the judge.
Uh-huh.
They told me, Aldo, what do you want to play, the judge or the Benny the cop?
I see.
I said, I'll play Benny the cop after I read the script.
I see.
Because Chuck Mitchell, in the story, maybe I shouldn't tell this, but in the story, when it's his turn to rape the girl, it's, you know, that kind of story. It's his turn to rape the girl. Everybody else has had a piece of her.
okay.
When it comes his turn, he undresses, and all he's got underneath is he's got women's panties on, a brassiere, and all that stuff.
Chuck
yeah.
is?
Yeah,
the
yeah,
big
yeah,
fat,
yeah,
fat
yeah,
Chuck.
Yeah, yeah, and he takes a belt off his pants and he beats her. That's his, I guess, his kicks. He starts beating on her.
No garter belt?
I don't know. Maybe probably has a garter too. I don't know. Anyhow, the story, they leave her for dead, they think. Uh-huh. And her lover, her real true love, comes yes. to the rescue. And the story really is how he, after this, the story uh-huh. is how he gets vengeance by killing every one of the people that
yes,
did her
yes,
in.
Yes, yes.
You know, one after another. Boom, 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 boom.
You were talking to Sherry Spillane here.
Yeah,
how
Sherry,
are you, Sherry?
Fine. I couldn't help but to jump
That's
in on
all
that.
Right,
that one
Sherry.
Was just too much for me.
Yes. Spillane.
Yes.
Are you still married to Mickey
That's
Spillane?
That's a very strange question. I was introduced as former. And,
former.
Yes.
But
and
you, I understand
that, you're... much in doubt in the courts at the moment, and it's kind of like trying to explain Einstein's theory of relativity. I don't understand it myself, and I can't touch it with a 10-foot pole, but the lawyers say the whole thing is totally in doubt right now.
It is in doubt.
Yeah.
And you've been married how long? 20 years?
20 years.
20
yeah.
years. Where did Mickey Spillane find Sherry Spillane?
He found me in a photographer's studio in New York, a dilapidated old building, four flights up. I had been posing for True Romance magazines.
True Romance?
Yes, True
this
Romance.
This is one of them right
this
here.
This is my entrance into show business.
True Romance? You did
yes.
this pose? I
uh-huh.
love it.
$15 an hour. Really? I really did very well.
$15 an hour?
$15 an hour, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Back in the early
back
1960s. Yes, titles like Nice Girls Don't Neck Like That.
Uh-huh.
And, My Steady Swore We Had Stopped in Time. And the photographer needed a blonde with dancer's legs for the back of one of Mickey's books.
Uh-huh.
And said to me, would you care to do the back cover of a book called The Girl Hunters from Mickey Spillane? And I said, who's Mickey Spillane? I'd never heard of him before in my life. And he said, if you come and you'll find out tomorrow.
Is this it?
That's not the original
not
one,
the
but
original?
this is the one we did in 1972, which is still on the stand, still selling uh-huh. today, and it won the Cover of the Year award.
Beautiful. Those yeah. legs, was, they go all the way up.
Well, it was
oh, yeah.
it was the very first wraparound all-nude book cover for a hardback uh-huh. staid company like E.P. Dutton, mm-hmm. And as I said, it's still on the stands today.
Mickey Spillane.
Yes.
Difficult to live with?
Oh. Extremely difficult.
Really?
Yeah. Very
Is he a drunk or did
yes.
he is?
He's an alcoholic. Yes, an alcoholic. I think there's a difference between an alcoholic and a drunk. A drunk
right.
is somebody who just likes to do it. An alcoholic is someone who can't help himself. And unfortunately, that's Mickey's problem. He
Still
to this day. That's why after 20 years, I just had to
drugs?
Walk away.
Any?
No.
Drugs?
Not
no drugs.
Just alcohol. Tons and tons of alcohol.
Drinks
starting
alone,
at 12 o'clock.
Alone?
Hides booze in soda cans. He'd be sitting there drinking a Coca-Cola and getting drunk, and I couldn't figure it out. And it's an alcoholic's trip.
So you must have had a rough time with him.
I had a very rough time. I tried for 20 years to get him to stop drinking, and it didn't work. And finally, I had to walk away because my life was just falling apart, and I couldn't take it anymore. I feel very sorry for him.
He was a drunk before. I mean,
he was an alcoholic when I met him.
Met him,
but
you
I
didn't know that.
Well, I didn't know what an alcoholic was. I had never been involved with, I never had that in my family. I knew nothing about it. I knew that he drank too much and that it changed his personality, but I wasn't really aware that he was an alcoholic.
Personality? What kind of personality? Mean or what?
Yes, very mean, very abusive, emotionally abusive, sexually abusive.
Sexually abusive?
Oh, yes.
Really?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And
when he's drinking.
When he's drinking,
but
yeah.
When he's not drinking.
Totally different when he's sober.
I think he would like to know, wouldn't you like to know, what is he like when he's not drinking?
Not drinking, yes.
Yeah.
What is he really like when he's not drinking?
When he's not drinking, he's the kind of a man who could get along with anybody, the President of the United States or somebody working, maintaining the streets.
I see.
Never stops talking.
He talks.
Constant. Never stops talking. He loves to just walk around in a pair of shorts and barefoot and a black t-shirt, mm-hmm. never gets dressed. The minute he gets drunk out of his mind, he puts his My Camera suit on, grabs his gun, and takes off.
My Camera suit on. I like. My Camera. You know that?
Oh.
My Camera.
Yes.
Eldo Ray
yes.
should be doing My Camera.
He is the
am I right?
Yeah.
I always felt that I would have that was a series that I should have been
I should have
done. Yeah.
You agree with me.
Oh, totally. I wish that I had something.
And that show that follows it, what's that, The Equalizer, that's another guy that I think I would do 10 times better.
No, but I say you know that, Mickey Spillane, you had been perfect for.
Yeah.
What happened?
Did you the hell knows? I don't know. No, nobody ever contacted me. I would never
Did you have, tell me about the money. Do you still get money on that show? Do you have any?
Well, that's part of the problem at the moment. That's up in the courts. And we're going into the Supreme Court in Nevada and possibly to the Supreme Court of the United States with it because it's they're giving me a hard time.
Mickey Spillane.
Are they giving you a hard time or your lawyers a hard time?
Well, both. Absolutely both.
I hate lawyers. They're rotten SOBs as far as I'm concerned.
Sherry,
yes.
You're a singer.
Yes.
You sing. You did Vegas and all those
things. Yes, I played Vegas. I played New York. I went all around the country working nightclubs. Mm-hmm. I stopped working about 10 years ago because Mickey didn't want me to work anymore. And
what name did you use 10 years? Sherry Spillane?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Singing and dancing?
Yes. Uh-huh. Singing and dancing and doing a lot of stage shows, musicals. Uh-huh. And I decided 2.5 weeks ago that I was going to go back to work in the business.
You are?
2.5 weeks ago, I started vocalizing again. And the voice is about 70%.
And you're
back.
With a wonderful agent, Miss Ruth Webb.
Miss Ruth Webb, she was my agent 15 years ago in New York City.
Uh-huh.
And I ran into her at a party about 2.5 weeks ago. I'd just gotten back into California. And
you just arrived?
I just arrived a few weeks ago.
Yeah. From where?
I've been back east in New York and back in Rhode Island where my family lives,
uh-huh.
and in Las Vegas. We had a huge trial going
nice
on
having
there.
Nice you in California.
Thank you. It's really nice to be back in California.
You do? Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes.
Elder Ray, you've been in California a long time. Do you find any difference in Hollywood change? There's a lot of change. We're on Sunset, you know.
Oh,
you
yeah.
work down the street here on Columbia Pictures.
I remember when the streetcars were up here, you know.
Yeah, right. You were Columbia. Harry, come. Let's get back to Harry.
Yeah, good old Harry.
Yeah, tell me
about people that were afraid of him.
You might have some wonderful stories about Harry Cohn.
Oh, people were afraid of him. They hate, you know, they didn't like him because they were afraid of him.
He ran Hollywood, Eldo.
He was a hell of a guy. He was really a great guy. He was like, when I ran my little town of Crockett, he ran Hollywood the same way, almost the same way.
Uh-huh.
That kind of, you know, I mean, but everybody was afraid of him.
Uh-huh.
See, but the only way he could get to me was pocketbook, and I couldn't care less.
Right.
You know, $200 a week in those days to me, that was fantastic money.
He was giving you $200 a week?
That's what I got as a
stock
big
contract.
As a big star, yeah. I was getting $200 a week.
Do you hear this, Mickey? Sherry, do you hear what he just said?
I hear that.
$200 a week.
Uh-huh.
Big star at Columbia Pictures.
Yeah.
That's
I embarrassed
it's hard
him.
To believe.
That's worse than my $15 an hour for True Romance.
Yeah.
Hey, I worked hard as a stevedore for 12 and 14 hours a day for 90 cents an hour. 90 cents an hour.
Uh-huh. Aldo.
Yeah.
You've been in the business a long time.
Yeah.
You're enjoying it. You're having a good time.
Oh, yeah, I love it. I love it even more now. You know, the Screen Actors Guild kicked me out of the guild.
Yeah. Why did they do that? Non-union movies,
they said non-union movies. But, you know, when I did a couple of those non-union movies, I was actually down and out. I was really broke. And one was before...
You had to go out and eat. You had to work.
And
exactly.
I had kids. I had two kids to kind of feed.
Right.
Yeah. But and the thing is, what really annoys me is I did a half a dozen pictures that were...
On union.
Union.
Oh, union. Okay.
That four of them, they reneged on paying me, and the guild would not go to bat for me to go get my money.
They didn't?
No. Absolutely so, not a thing.
The union kicked you out now? Are you out?
Yeah, they kicked me out now. I've never gotten formal notice from them. All I know is when I read the newspapers and the phone calls I get.
Why don't you get a lawyer and fight it?
I don't. What the hell do I care? They can't stop me from working.
They can't?
No, I work in SAG movies, non-SAG, anything I want to work in. But the last half dozen movies I worked in are all SAG movies.
Oh, you can work in SAG movies and be kicked out of the union, too?
I don't understand it.
Okay.
They said that, from what I read in the newspapers, I never got a notice myself,
uh-huh.
but from what I read in the newspapers, I cannot vote in the union things, I cannot participate in debates, I cannot, you know, garbage.
But you could work.
Yeah.
You can work.
Yeah. Well, and I don't have to pay dues.
Elder Ray.
And I don't pay dues.
That's Elder Ray.
Not significant, but the
not drinking now.
No.
Clean as a whistle.
Not that clean. Not that clean, but you know, pretty clean.
But you're going to AA meetings.
I went to hundreds of those.
Yeah, you go to AA.
They're fun, yeah. They're fun.
Did you ever take Mickey?
You gotta go to one.
I have been.
I tried to take Mickey to an AA meeting. He would not admit that he was an alcoholic. He does not believe that he has a problem. And they told me that there was nothing I could do unless he admitted it.
You got to hold your hand and say, I'm an alcoholic.
Well, yes, but he would not admit, even when I caught him with a Coca-Cola can filled with booze, he would not admit that he was an alcoholic. And unfortunately, he's doing all these...
90-proof Coca-Cola.
Yeah, he's doing these Miller-like beer ads.
Sherry, you mean you're sitting there telling me Mickey Spillane never took pills?
Never took pills? No, nothing.
Where did Mickey Spillane come from? Where's he originally from?
He was born
from?
In Brooklyn.
He's a Brooklyn
boy. New York. Mm-hmm. Yeah, uh-huh. The son of a bartender.
Uh-huh. Was he a gangster?
No.
He was never a gangster.
He likes to say that he is on the police side and goes out on all these police busts, but he never saw it, so. He's got a very good imagination.
I see.
Yes.
But he is actually a pussycat then, is he?
When he's not drunk, he's a really nice man.
But when he's drunk, he's violent.
When he's drunk, he's abusive. He's emotionally abusive. He's verbally, sexually abusive. It's pathetic.
Has he ever tied you up or anything like that?
No, he hasn't tied me up. He's dragged me out of cars and...
I see. Aldo Ray.
Skip, when I used to drink heavy, I used to go to sleep in a corner, to heck with it. Yeah, and I'm never aggressive.
Oh, no.
I was the other way. I go, just go to sleep.
Yeah. Aldo, tell me something. You've been married 3 times or 4 times?
Three.
3 times. You have, how many children do you have?
I have a daughter by my first wife. Uh-huh. I have a grandchild. I have a granddaughter whom I don't ever see, but
but you have a kid. Beautiful. You have a boy in the business, right?
Yeah, I have 2 sons here. Yeah,
they're in the business. One is.
Eric. My Eric. Yeah.
He's a very talented young man, and your wife is a ex-wife is a casting director.
Yeah, Joanna Ray. Yeah.
And the other wife is. Who?
Jeff Donnell, wife. She's on that General Hospital thing. Yeah. Uh-huh.
She's a lovely lady.
And she's been around. You know, she's been in this town for, 40 years. Or more.
A rough time here in Hollywood, looking back over?
Well, looking back...
over your life right now.
Yeah, but the thing is, the rough times I probably brought on myself, you know.
Go ahead.
All you do, if you don't participate, nothing happens. So when you participate, you got to behave their way, and I'm not particularly the kind of guy that behaves their way.
Were you a boozer? You know, Spencer Tracy and all those great guys, they were boozers.
Yeah.
Were you a heavy boozer with James Bacon all those guys?
Well, I used to socialize with those guys.
That's what I mean.
You know, and we used to drink a hell of a lot, but never got picked up by the cops. I never had a 502 or, any of those kind of things.
Uh-huh. Where was the in place in town at the time you used to go? The Polo Lounge was the in place? No. What was the in place? Bars? Cock and Bull?
Cock and Bull.
They were flying from New York.
That was an in place for a lot of people.
Cock and Bull, drinkers.
Yeah. Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah, what's Sonny Tufts, that's where he got, I think that ultimately did him in, Sonny. But he had arthritis of the spine.
I see.
Sonny did. And,
what kind of guy was Sonny Tufts?
Hell of a nice guy.
Was he really?
Yeah, great guy,
Cock and Bull.
It's the only restaurant that Mickey had a charge account in. He would fly from New York and go to the Cock and Bull, get loaded, go back to New York.
And go back to New York.
The other night I said to my kids, I said, hey, you guys, I'll meet you for dinner at the Tale of the Cock in the Valley.
Uh-huh.
And my older boy didn't know about it because he's been going to school up at Davis, in Sacramento. And my Eric, my younger boy, said, Dad, there's no more Tale of the Cock.
Uh-huh.
I said, you're kidding. No, I said, I know there's no more Tale of the Cock on La Cienega.
It's all changed.
But I said, the one in the valley. Uh-huh. No, they're bought out. They're closed.
Uh-huh.
I said, okay, then we'll have dinner somewhere else. And so we had dinner at Gio's.
Right.
And I went by. I deliberately went by the Tale of the Cock in the Valley, and there it was, all boarded up. I couldn't believe it, because during the 50s, that was like a pretty good watering hole.
See.
You know, the Sportsman's Lodge, before it became the big thing that it is. It was nicer then. I hate it now.
Aldo Ray.
It was nicer then.
Do you have a woman in your life right now?
Not really, no.
Not really?
No.
No steady girl?
No, I had one for quite 2.5 years. I had a nice lady from home, but we just didn't come to the wire.
You just got back from Italy. You did a movie called?
The Sicilian.
The Sicilian.
Yeah.
Now, who's in that?
It's a good movie.
Who's in the film?
Who's the kid that played... what's that Tarzan thing? The English Tarzan thing. The English, the Tarzan thing in England that they did about the family.
It doesn't matter about anyway.
Anyhow, they use mostly English people.
It is
in the cast. You know, as Sicilians.
Yes, I see. Your film in Italy, Palermo.
Huh? Palermo. Yeah, Well, back in the hills there, they don't use the city that much.
Yes.
Because the story takes place mostly in the mountains and in the small towns.
It's beautiful there. I lived there in Cefalù, right outside of Palermo. Yeah. It was lovely. You ever been to Italy?
No.
Oh, it's wonderful.
Well, I've been to Milan and to Rome.
Yeah, Shuffaloo is a lovely little resort town. It's beautiful.
You know what's interesting, Skip? I know another company that's going to do the Sicilian, another Sicilian.
There's going to be another one?
Yeah, well, see, the thing is, it's historical fact, and you cannot copyright history.
Yeah.
You cannot copyright history. So that another company is going to do it, and they're going to use Maui as Sicily.
Interesting.
And you can see, I don't know if you're knowing Sicily.
Yes, yes,
you
same
can
thing.
See it.
Yes, yes, yes.
Right
same
there.
Thing.
Absolutely.
Yes,
honest to goodness, yeah.
Why do they say that Italians are mafiosa? Always at Italians. I don't believe that. Because I'm Italian too.
Yeah.
See, I'm half Italian, half Jewish. And I just don't believe the Italians are always the mafiosa. Mickey Spillane is Jewish, isn't he?
No, Mickey Spillane is Irish.
He's Irish.
Yes.
Well, there's an Irish mafia. There's a Jewish mafia.
He's an Irish Catholic.
Irish Protestant. Protestant.
Yeah. Well, there's an Irish mafia. There's a Jewish mafia. There's a Mexican mafia. You know, they're all over the damn place.
That's true. Jewish people don't become alcoholics. Most of them.
Very few. Irish people.
See,
have
Irish,
a problem.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Irish
but Jewish
have a big
people
problem.
Very look back. They really don't become alcoholics.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, he had a wonderful excuse. He kept saying, "How can I be an alcoholic when I've written all these books?" And he said, "But Mickey, you work from 6 o'clock until 10 in the morning,
and then
you start drinking at 12." So, he wrote 26 books.
Where did he get his 26?
26 books, yes.
And where did he get his?
He would lie on the couch watching cartoons and be writing a book in his head.
In his head?
Yeah, right. Now, that's a trick that I learned from him, and now I'm writing.
You're writing.
Now I'm lying on a couch watching cartoons.
And are you writing?
I am writing a trashy Hollywood novel.
Tell me about it.
Trashy Hollywood. And it's about Hollywood.
I like that. Hollywood is trashy.
Sounds
it's
true.
Very
it sounds like a true story.
It's very
Jackie Collins. My true story.
It is true story. Eldo, you've been around here. You are a silver screen star, so you could say.
I
yeah, right.
Tell me. What is any gossip about it?
There's a lot of gossip. The main character is a drunken mystery writer.
That's Mickey Spillane, okay.
And there are a lot of very colorful characters in the book, and there are a lot of very sensual and sexual scenes and some very nasty scenes.
So it is actually Mickey Spillane's life.
I'm not going to say that.
I
don't want to be hit with any form of libel, but every character, every fictional character is based on real people. Mickey always wrote about real people. Whoever he had in his book was based on someone.
Always real.
The girl in the erection set was based on me. Every character that he had was based on somebody that he knew.
I see.
So I learned a great number of tricks from him, and I'm going to use them in my book.
You can learn tricks from people by
living
with people.
I learned a lot of tricks. Yes, yes. I remember what he said was that when you write a book, the first page has to grab them right away. So I've done it in the second sentence.
What is your second sentence? What is it?
I can't tell you.
Come on.
No, I can't. I can't copyright it, so I can't tell you.
Is there a bitch in it?
Oh, there are a lot of bitches.
Hollywood's full of bitches. Do you believe in casting couches in Hollywood? They're
all over the place.
All over.
Oh yeah.
Casting couches.
Casting in Hollywood over the years. Like I came here in 1950.
Right.
Casting couches here were always for women. And I found out that in England, the casting couches are for men.
Men.
Yeah.
And now they're becoming men here. Now.
Oh yeah.
Men
oh,
are doing
Jesus.
It now. Very oh, big.
And the couches are larger than ever.
So once you. Why don't
king
you write
size,
something?
King
why
size.
Don't you write something about that?
Oh, that'll be in my book.
You know,
without a doubt.
Really?
Oh yes, yes.
Tell me some of the very marvelous, colorful people you've met here in Hollywood.
I've been living with
Mickey Spillane. I mean, really.
I never really met a lot of colorful Hollywood people with Mickey. Mickey was not the kind of a person who liked to go to parties. Mickey liked to stay home and be in bed by 10 o'clock and be up by 6.
And you had to be there.
Oh yes. Well, see, we lived together 6 weeks on and 6 weeks off for 20 years.
What?
We never lived together constantly. He liked South Carolina. I hated it. So we had an apartment in New York, a house in Carolina, and an apartment here in California, and I worked in Vegas for a while.
Yes.
So we would meet. We would spend 6 weeks together, and then he would go on the road with a book, and I would join him to do the publicity because I did most of his covers. And then if I was working, sometimes he would come along and stay with me, and then we'd meet here in California, and then we'd split apart for 6 weeks, and then we'd be back together. And that went on for 20 years.
Sherry?
Yes.
Did you enjoy that? I mean, I think it might
I got used to it. Let me put it that way. What would happen
was
just...
Did you live in hotels mostly? Or houses?
When we were on the road, we had apartments. We had an apartment in New York and an apartment here in California. Mm-hmm. And
the one in South Carolina.
That's a house. That's
Howard Hughes. Did you know him, Elder?
No.
You never met Howard Hughes?
I never got to know him, no.
He never lived in a home, always in a hotel. Mm. Always.
Yes.
Always a hotel. Yeah. You met Howard Hughes, didn't you?
Never.
You never met him?
No, never met him. Wish I
had.
Fascinating,
you know,
man.
Yes.
Excuse me. Yeah, back in 51,
yes.
I took a house at the beach down at the base of Topanga Canyon, mm-hmm. and a couple of doors over was Gene Peters.
Mm-hmm. Howard's ex-wife.
Yeah. And she was a prisoner in her, this huge house that she was in. She was like a prisoner there.
Right.
And she used to, from what I heard later on, you know, talking, she used to watch me and Jeff Donnell walk, gallivanting on the beach
right.
and
mm-hmm.
having a ball and having fun. And and she envied us because she was a prisoner in her house.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I was a prisoner in my apartment when Mickey was in town. I wasn't allowed to answer the phone.
No answering phone?
No, because
who
when he
the
was
phone?
There... He would answer the phone, or it would be on the answering machine, but when he was there, he wanted my attention 24 hours a day. That was it. His thing was, we're not together all the time, and when you're with me and nobody else.
Mm.
And I was not allowed to see my friends.
Did you have to cook for him?
I did cook. At that particular time, I was not the world's greatest cook. I'm a very good cook now. Mickey did a lot of the cooking.
He did?
He was a very good cook.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
excellent. I'm a good cook, too.
Are you?
No.
I see. I did not know Mickey Spillane was Irish. I did not know
yes.
that. And he's from Brooklyn.
He's from Brooklyn.
I see. And how's his health today?
He's had heart problems for a long time, but mm-hmm. That's connected with the alcoholism. He has auricular fibrillations. And that's...
Do you speak on the phone?
We
often?
Don't talk at all now. Unfortunately, it was not a nice split. He was very angry that I left him.
Mm-hmm.
And things have not been...
I see. Does he know you're writing a book about
I don't know if he does or not.
You'll know now.
He'll be, yes, he'll find out.
Is this the first time you've announced that you're writing a book right
this
now?
This is the first time that I have announced it on television. I have,
right now?
Yes, this
and
is.
And the book is going to be called?
I have not
come
got
up
a
with
title
it?
Yet for it.
Uh-huh.
And titles can't be copywritten.
Uh-huh.
And so when I do come up with a really good one, I'm going to hang on to it. That's another mm-hmm. trick I love.
I see. So you haven't come up with the title yet?
I have a couple racing around in my mind right now, but I'm not 100%
when
sure.
Are we going to hear about this book? When is it coming out? How
long
is it
I would imagine it will take me another 6 months to
another
complete
6 months.
It.
Eldo, how about everybody's writing books? How about you? Eldo Ray.
Well, I had a half a dozen.
You've had an interesting life.
I had a half a dozen, writers approach me to write my biography, and I committed myself to one guy. I said, okay, you write it, but I haven't heard from him. I wrote him 70 pages of background stuff, legal pages, and I write small.
Yes.
And I wrote up to the beginning of Sadie Thompson with Rita Hayworth, and I sent him all those 70 pages,
Is that the right way to do it, Sherry, like he's doing it? What do you think?
Writing 70 pages?
And no, the way he's doing it, the beginning, just writing. Don't you think it's on a tape machine better?
Well, I do it the same way.
You do?
I've sat down and with a pen and a yellow pad, and I
just
write whatever comes in.
Mickey
never did it that way. Mickey would sit down at the typewriter and never rewrite anything.
Never
rewrite. He wrote it, and that was it. It stayed exactly the same.
No kidding.
And I saw him finish a book in 3 days. I saw him finish one in 3 weeks. He hasn't written one in a few years now.
Uh-huh. Interesting.
Not writing right now.
I'll be done.
Did it do it?
Yeah, that's
it.
And nobody touched it. Uh-huh. He once had a book in there, and editors added commas.
Yes.
Something like 200 commas, and he got very angry and had the girl fired.
Uh-huh.
Looking back.
Yes.
Stella Stevens. You're beautiful. You know that?
Thank you.
Stella Stevens, tell me, Mississippi, born?
Born in Mississippi.
Really?
That's right. Yes. I always but love the state, too.
It is a good city. It really is. The state is a good state. But tell me about Memphis, Tennessee. That's where you really grew up.
Well, I grew up there because my parents moved there when I was about 4 years old.
Uh-huh.
And I went through all my school years until I quit high school, got married.
You quit
and
high
had
school?
A baby, yes. And then Andrew was born, and after he was born, I went back to finish school at night,
uh-huh.
at night school, and then I went on to Memphis State University, uh-huh. where I got my first big break as an actress.
You did a play. It was what was it
Bus
called?
Stop.
Bus Stop.
Yes.
Marilyn Monroe.
That's right. Sherry in Bus Stop.
Sherry.
And I had done several other plays in Memphis, but that was the one that got me really noticed because a man named Edwin Howard wrote about me in the newspaper
right.
and gave me a great review and maybe gave me the courage to come on out to California and try. I was a fashion model at that time.
You were?
Yes, I was modeling Junior Sophisticates and Mr. Mort clothes
uh-huh.
at Goldsmith's Department Store, Memphis' largest department store,
uh-huh.
was my first job. And, of course, I had the baby at that time.
Andrew?
And Andrew, yes. And I made $38.86 a week, and I used to have to take Andrew to the nursery while I went to work. There was a nursery in the department store itself.
Uh-huh.
And I lived through that. And then my next job was at 20th Century Fox, where I was making $250 a week, and I thought I was really rich. I was.
They put you under contract?
Yes.
Stock?
I was going to be the girl to play Jean Harlow. Mm. I was brought out to play Jean Harlow,
uh-huh.
and I never played her. Although I met William Powell and other people that had known her very well, and I remember William Powell said to me, "Oh God, Stella, don't do it." I loved her, and they made too much of it, and she was a wonderful girl and nothing like they said, and don't play her.
Uh-huh.
And he never wanted me to. That's not why I didn't play her. They actually didn't make the movie that they had the script of at that time.
Right.
Which Jerry Adler had, and it was written by Adler Rogers St. John. Mm-hmm. Years later, they did two movies on the life of Jean Harlow.
Baker.
Carol Baker and Carol Linley did
but
one.
But Baker. So. Oh, wasn't Baker great doing it?
Yes, yes.
Linley was good, but Baker was sensational in it. I loved her.
It was a very nice film, yeah. but it was certainly, it perpetrated the myth that William Powell said was not true at all, and he didn't want seen because uh-huh. he thought she was a great girl.
Little Abner, come on, Stella Stevens.
Appassionata von Climax, please.
Little That's Abner, darling.
Mm-hmm.
Come on.
My first starring role.
It was your first starring role?
Yes. Definitely. And I went to Paramount. From that, when they showed the film of Little Abner, I mm-hmm. was put under contract and was there for 5 years. They picked me up from that picture.
I see.
Appassionata von Climax, the mistress to the richest man in the world, General Bull Moose.
You've always played sexy Rose.
Oh, thank God.
Oh, you're right. Always been sexy. And but then what happened?
I haven't always played sexy roles. I have played nuns and I have played mother superiors where sex may have been there,
That's
but it was
right.
covered with
Come
a
on.
Habit.
There
you
was
see.
Sex in there.
you kinky boy, you put on a nun's habit and you get all turned on. that was fun, but it was not overtly sexy. Let's put it that way.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Flamingo Road.
Flamingo Road. I played NBC's first madam.
Yeah.
That's true. They
How did you get that? How did you get that role?
Well, I graduated from hooker to madam. You know, where else can you go?
You're right.
I played a lot of hookers, and one of the most fun was in a movie called Mom, where I played this outrageous red-haired hooker named Beverly Hills. She was fun. Her real name was Beverly Schneider. But
Do you enjoy doing those roles, Stella?
I am basically a comedian.
You
I always have been, and so. The sex has always been comedy sex, or
yes.
A lot of the serious dramatic roles I've played, I think to myself, oh God, it's just kind of dreary.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And I like the pacing of comedy, and I like the excitement of it, and I love action, I love physical comedy.
I see.
And I was not able to do very much physical comedy on Santa Barbara. I did that
That's
for
right,
a year.
You did that.
Yes, I did a year of that, playing Robin Mattson's character, Gina's mother,
right?
Who was called Phyllis Blake. And I tell you, people wrote to us saying that we reminded them of Lucy and Ethel. That was the highest compliment I could hope for. But it would not allow us very much physical comedy. It was mostly close-up
uh-huh.
comedy,
uh-huh. Uh-huh.
where just the lines have to prevail.
Marilyn Monroe. comedy too. Sexy girl, blonde, sexy.
Comedy, yes.
Stella Stevens. When I think of Stella, I think of Marilyn Monroe too.
I probably saw her first.
She was a comedian, really.
Oh, very much so. Yes, yeah. One of my favorite films of hers is The 7-Year Itch.
The best.
The Tom Yule.
Me too.
See, I adore that film. Yeah. And, of course, Some Like It Hot.
Oh, I love that, yeah.
One of my very favorite directors, of course.
Wilder.
Billy Wilder did
is
that.
Is he film. One of your favorite directors?
Absolutely. I mean, Sunset Boulevard is one of my very, very favorite films of all time. I would love to play Norma Desmond, you see, if they ever make
did
a
redo it again?
That. Oh, God. What a wonderful role.
You like that law has been movie star, you know, hidden away.
I would love to do that, yes. It intrigues me.
Joe Fury and Lee Grant has a script.
Oh,
it's
yeah?
called I'm Waiting. It's about an old actress hidden away. It's just like Sunset Boulevard, you know?
Well, there would be hope for me in later years to play things like that without a lot of makeup, see?
if would I'm going to Would you like to take chances? You like to take, you're an actress, Shelley. You like to take chances.
I just went and read for a part of someone in her 60s, and I think a lady who actually was in her 60s got the role. She was eyeing me, gave me the fisheye when I came in, like, what are you doing here? And I thought, well, there are makeup men, and I can play the hell out of the role. Let's see if they can make me look the role, you know. I didn't get it, but I went out for it anyway, and I enjoyed actually auditioning for the role because I knew I could handle it and do the part well, but I was not physically yet right for it. So I like it when they write exciting roles for older people.
You were so busy growing up with your child, working.
I was much older when I was young than I am now, I feel.
But how
did
Andrew get into acting?
Andrew got into acting after going back to Memphis and going to school there.
He did.
And joining the drama group and
you didn't force
winning
him at all?
Possibly 30 or 40 trophies for his school in acting. They had what was called duet acting. He and his girlfriend went to Nashville and won the state championship.
Did they really?
So he came by it honestly, I guess. I was the black sheep of the family, and everybody was really ashamed of me when I left to go and try out here with the evils of Hollywood, because no one in my family had ever done that.
And, evils of Hollywood?
Oh, of course. And actually, I was in Playboy magazine. I was the January 1960 Playmate of the Month. And the preacher in the First Baptist Church in Memphis, Tennessee, preached a sermon against me, setting me up as a young lady who was typical of all young women led astray by the evils of Hollywood.
Really?
And so I was just symbolic.
How do you feel about that, Stella, when they put terrible things in a print about Stella Stevens? How does Stella handle that?
I don't handle it as well as I should. It kind of makes me angry, but I try not to show it. Because quite recently, there is a man who has sworn a vendetta against me for some unknown reason. And he has a column, and I appeared, I was wearing a pantsuit very much like I'm wearing now, only it was white, and it was quite elegant. In fact, I always get a lot of compliments when I wear it. And so in this column, he wrote that my hair was dirty, and I looked tacky like I was about to take out the garbage. And I thought, well, people don't put on white clothing to take out the garbage, and this man really is doing what he threatened to do. And so maybe I will make the 10 worst dressed women list.
Oh,
and
I
if
know.
I do that.
Is this the man? Oh
yeah.
Mr. B.
Then maybe that'll be worth some good publicity, huh?
Did he really say that?
Yeah, he did.
You don't care about that as long as they spell your name
I do
right.
take out the garbage, but usually I'm not dressed in my best outfits when I do it, and I don't go out with dirty hair.
So, Andrew, let's talk about Andrew. Andrew got back into Hollywood. How did he get to Hollywood after Memphis?
He came back and started going to school at USC,
right.
making films. And so Andrew has graduated now into actor, writer, director.
Same as his mother.
Well, he's writing and directing his own films. I'm quite proud of him.
You are proud of him?
Yes, of course. And hopefully when he directs things, he'll put me in them, you know.
Are you very close with Andrew? Because that's your only son. Is that...
We have had our
Stella
ups and downs, but we're actually quite close now. We have a good time together. I think what did it best to turn the tide of any animosity between mother and son was when I put him in the first film I directed. First feature film I directed was called The Ranch, and Andrew starred in it. And he said to me, gee, you're so patient. I said, you don't remember yourself as a child, obviously, Andrew, or you would know where I got this patience, because Andrew taught me patience, I think. But actually, a great thrill was working with him as a director and uh-huh. being directed by him.
Uh-huh.
And I found him quite patient on the set with the actors and quite good. I think people who are actors are better with other actors. They're more sympathetic.
Sympathetic,
with
yes.
the quirks and strange eccentricities we have about why we can't walk somewhere and say a line. I understand that.
What made you turn to be a director also? Stella?
It's the only logical way to go up from starring in things and having the leading
sexy
part.
Sexy movies and sexy roles all the time, Stella.
No, you're wrong about that.
Okay,
they were
go
not
ahead,
all
Stella.
The time. No,
no,
as I said to you, I played nuns.
I
played
know you have, superiors. I know, but there's a lot.
I played very sexy roles in very few movies, and they have been later in life.
Life, I see.
In my early life, I kind of rejected that, not wanting to get typecast. And
okay.
one of the first things I did that was directed by Robert Altman, the only thing I've ever done directed by Robert Altman, but a really good piece of work, was a Bonanza with Michael Landon, in which I right. played a deaf mute like Johnny Belinda. And that was really good acting that I had to do, and not sexy at all, although I was raped by Albert Salmi. But I went out of my way to try to get roles that were not based on sex.
You really did.
And right now,
I see.
I don't care anymore, because uh-huh. when people just go crazy and look at me and think I'm some sex symbol now, I find that, you know, very flattering and quite uh-huh. nice. And I don't have anything to prove in that area anymore.
Not anymore. You don't
no.
have to. Yes,
so
absolutely.
If I do it, like one of my fans wrote and said, the thing I did in Mom was one of the sexiest, funniest things he'd ever seen me do. Now, it was not a very successful picture, but certainly it was one of the most outrageous hookers I've ever played.
Right.
So I have fun with the roles I do. I enjoy doing that. I enjoy directing people because the director has... can get fingers into every
yes,
pie.
Yes.
I can go pick at people and make uh-huh. them look good. I can get into the makeup and the hair and the props and the everything, you know.
So
and
I've Stella worked likes with, to work on the other side of that camera and
oh,
sees.
Very
and
much
sees.
So.
You do?
Yes. I would much rather eventually get into yeah. that all the way.
Yes.
Actually, after working with people like Bob Hope and some of the others who have been around and are still working in their 80s, I hope I'm still acting then too. But I really would prefer to be a director more
you
than
but,
an
yes.
actor at uh-huh. that time. And I'm working on a couple of properties now. One is a sex comedy. The other is a thriller about a serial killer.
Uh-huh.
So they are very separate and different kind of
you
things.
Just got back from filming what, where
A Dangerous Curves.
Dangerous Curves.
Yes.
In Dallas?
In Dallas.
In Dallas.
Yes, we shot in North Dallas in a mansion there that was just
uh-huh.
incredible.
What's the movie about, actually?
Mine is called In the Name of Love.
Mm-hmm.
And I play a character named Muffy Fuller. And I get killed by a former lover in it,
uh-huh.
so I'm murdered in it.
Uh-huh.
So Muffy Fuller, as the name
right.
sort of implies,
uh-huh.
is a social butterfly,
right, right.
very wealthy there in Texas.
I heard someone say Sharon Stone said something to you. She's,
oh,
yes.
Good.
Did you see Basic Instincts?
I did, of
I
course.
Said, and one of her interviews said that she... love Stella Stevens. She got her ideas from Stella
well,
Stevens.
God, isn't that...
Now,
I'm
Sharon Stone
that
got her ideas.
Because, yeah, I'm a big fan of hers. I loved what she did in that movie. And
Basic Instincts?
I said, I wish I could have done that, you know,
uh-huh.
because...
Would you really like to
she
do that?
Did the type of things that I always wished I could do, but I never got a role like that. No one ever offered me that role, because I was not playing sexy roles
uh-huh.
at that time.
Uh-huh.
But... I think in Slaughter, that was probably one of the sexiest roles I played, but mm-hmm. It was not a very popular picture for
mm-hmm.
me,
mm-hmm.
and I don't think they have played it very much on television because there was a very
right.
explicit love scene in it
right.
between me and Jim Brown.
Right.
And so...
Because he's black, you think,
maybe? At that time, yes. At that time,
because, yes.
And at that time, it caused a furor in the South, and I was
were
very,
you nude?
I was very
nude?
Hated.
Were you very nude? Nudity? A lot of nudity?
Yes, but it was so dark, I couldn't see very much
uh-huh.
of anything. The
uh-huh.
lighting was very diffused and dark. And I was a little disappointed because I wanted to see more, because I had done more.
Right.
And I was very disappointed in the impact of it. But what happened was... two things from that. They filmed it, And then they screened it only for the guys in the back room
over and over,
and they kept little clips of it. They also
cut
out 35-millimeter frames and sold them to Playboy magazine.
Kidding.
No, I'm not kidding.
Isn't that against the law?
Oh, probably so, but who cares? Oh. They did it anyway.
Stella, do you think audiences today like sex movies? They're very much into Basic Instincts and all these sex movies today. Then... and violence. They love violence and sex. You've been in films a long time now. Come on.
Sexual violence as well.
Yes, sexual violence.
Of course. Well, what
I makes it so attractive? Is it because all of us inside ourselves would like that experience, do you think?
I'm sure, yes, of course. I mean, being as big a sex symbol as I was after doing the Playboy magazine spreads, three or four of those over the years.
Have you had any dangerous calls in your lifetime?
Because only in the very early years. I think after people realized I was such a good shot with a shotgun and stuff like that, they began to leave me alone. Huh? I'm an excellent marksman. I like shooting. In fact, I'm going back to the celebrity shoot this year. Uh-huh. I'm very good with a gun. And I also love to fight.
I am really
a fighter.
You brought a clip.
And you know what I love to fight?
Ahead.
I love to fight other women. It's one of the most exciting things for me. You know, Sharon Stone.
Yeah.
Sharon Stone had a wonderful fight with another woman, and
right.
I loved that fight.
I saw it.
So I brought a clip for you.
Yes.
If Sharon likes me, she's going to love
okay,
this
clip. Okay, I want to see this clip. What is this clip?
This clip is a compilation. Now, you know I want to be a director.
You're
so
an excellent director.
I have put together a compilation of things that I did from certain films to just show. And this was a lot of action and fighting that I did with other women.
I'd love to see it.
Okay, great. Let's
okay,
run it.
Okay, Stella, other women.
Of your holier-than-thou attitude, no common thread exists. Derman was a total stranger to me before today, so you can kiss your theory goodbye, Lady Celeste.
I'd rather you kissed my husband goodbye, you adulterous. Slimy pink shit.
For stinking nigger. You want it, don't you? You want that black bastard, huh? You want it, don't you?
Yes. Yes, I want him!
You rotten bitch.
Fight fair.
fine. It's just, Rip Torn is one of the best actors around. This is the guy who really beats you up there, kick you.
That's right. See, if I fight women, I win. If I fight Rip Torn, he wins.
He's such a great actor.
Yeah, he's terrific.
Why all these violence? People love violence movies, don't they, Stella?
Well, it's action.
Is it action?
Yes, of course.
I say violence, but you say action.
Yes, well, it's...
I know it's only a movie, like you said.
Over the top lately with the... You know, but you saw there were no Uzis. We didn't mow people down and things like that. No, I like the one-on-one confrontation. I like that.
Kids love it. Kids who go to the theater really love that, don't they? Mm-hmm. They get excited, especially when they see two women fighting.
Yeah, I think that's exciting. I've always loved it. You know, in Destry, Rides Again, remember there's a wonderful fight.
Of course,
fight.
Great.
And my heroine always was Marlena. So
Marlena?
I adored
She's
her.
She's great.
So, you know, watching her fight there, I always admired her. And I love to fight women. Mm-hmm. I like to fight them better than men.
So Stella Stevens really looks up to Dietrich, Marilyn, all these great beauties who really are real women. These
well,
people
Rosalind
are real
Russell,
women.
Claudette Colbert,
yeah, these are women. You're looking at
Myrna
women.
Loy.
Yeah.
Oh, of course. Yes. Yeah.
You consider yourself a real woman.
I consider myself a tomboy.
And a tomboy?
I always have been all my life.
Okay.
And I've grown into what I believe is a real woman, but a lot of times I've felt like I acted like a female impersonator.
Really?
Because there is such an image of pretense and of sort of plastic unreal quality which people do expect and so therefore I give it to them and they like it, like these nails, for instance. I broke a nail so bad I had to repair it before coming on this show, but this is from The Dangerous Curves from Muffy Fuller.
Your movie,
so now it's a holdover from that. But I went riding on my horses on Sunday and putting a bridle on, I lost
that's right
one of these
you moved
things.
up in Washington State and you came back.
Yes,
you
I lived there 12 years
12
and,
up
and now I'm back. Same old
you had house. A ranch up there.
I had a ranch, 101 acres, totally surrounded by national forest.
Oh, that's great,
place,
Stella.
Yes.
What did you do all the time when you were
up
there?
I just played and had fun.
Did you?
Had a good time.
Do you have a man in your life right now?
I do. I have had a man in my life for the past 8.5 years. Mm. Isn't that amazing?
That's great,
Stella. He's lasted longer than anyone in my life. And
Wow, you're tough to be with. You're saying the last any...
Well, I would say every relationship lasted about 1.5 years, and after that it sort of petered out. You know, it was,
why is that, Stella? Busy?
It would just be that people grow and they grow apart, and it would be that instead of growing together and staying together and working at it, as Bob and I have, we've grown apart.
What does Stella Stevens want in a man? What is you looking for? What are you looking for in a man?
I was looking for, back in the days I was looking for a man, I was looking for someone with a sense of humor and someone that I could talk with and exchange ideas with. And Bob is a musician. He is in heavy rock and roll, heavy metal rock and roll, which doesn't seem the type of person that you would have an intellectual conversation with. But after the heat of passion wore out, we found out that we did have still a lot to talk about and a lot to have fun about. And he has become my best friend. And so
that's important.
That is the
most important
thing.
Sense of humor and best friend.
Yes, he
I
has
like
a great sense of humor. And no matter how angry I get and if I blow my top, I have probably a worse temper than he does.
Does he let you have it?
But he has been able in his life to be with the most impossible stars and back them up as a lead guitarist so that he has seen quite a few star fits in his day, you know, and so mine don't impress him any more than some others. I mean, at least I don't lie on the floor and kick and cry and do stuff like that. He has even seen that, you know. So I believe his experience has helped him in how to deal with me. But also, I find out that, or I feel that a man is with a woman kind of the way he has been or is with his mother. And Bob is excellent with his mother. And he and his mother have a very good relationship. And that's a clue to how good a man is going to be with a woman.
So
how he is with his mother.
So
now, don't ask me about Andrew.
Don't ask you. But Stella is spiritual, then. Mm. You're very spiritual. I see it.
I didn't know it showed.
Yeah.
I suppose it. Yes, yeah. I... I am a spiritual person in that I still have a great deal of morality. I feel like as a director, I would be Frank Capra or something. Uh-huh. You understand?
Yes.
I love idealism. Uh-huh. I love romantic idealism uh-huh. better than anything. Mm-hmm. I love excellence.
Looking over your life, Stella Stevens, looking back, had a good time in your life, would you say?
All in all, I've had an excellent adventure in my life, and
because you came to Hollywood, the days it really was here. I mean, come on, Stella.
A lot of it
glamour.
Is still here. A lot
you
of it is still
here. You think there's glamour still here? They dress in jeans. They go out. They don't look like movie stars, Stella.
Well, we have been browbeaten into not looking like movie stars out in
public.
Why?
Tell me why.
Because. People thought that was pretentious, and people thought that was too standoffish. And if someone puts one on a pedestal, that's fine, but don't put yourself up there.
Okay,
you understand that?
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's the reason.
So you've had a good time?
I was told first never to go out without makeup and my hair done and never to, you know, now, and I lived in Washington and went out without makeup and without my hair done. My hair was not dirty, but it still was not done.
Did you hear that, Mr. Blackwell? Go ahead.
So, I've had a wonderful time, but I've had rough years. I've had years of time when I did not work a lot, and I have had...
So you've had some
one
rough,
of the hardest
rough
struggles of anyone I've known to try to go from acting to directing because of starting out a sex pot, a sex symbol.
Right.
This has been a detriment in trying to have people take me seriously as a director. But I find that those clouds are going away now and that all the impact other women directors, wonderful directors like Barbara Streisand and Jodie Foster and Lee Grant. And
these are great directors.
Yes, they're very wonderful. Great directors, wonderful women. And this is opening the
how
doors.
How did you feel? How did Stella Stevens felt when they didn't even recognize Streisand at the awards this year? It just upset me a little. She did such a great job. As a woman director, as
it
yourself.
It upsets me. It upsets me that she was not mentioned very much for Yentl either. But
Yentl,
What does a woman have to do?
Tell me, what do they have to do, Stella?
I don't know, but I
know the
know
casting
that,
couch is still out there and all that crap. It's been all the, well, he's always in out here, but I don't think women should. They're getting their part though, aren't you? Don't think so?
I would hope so. I do hope to direct these films that I'm working on. I hope they're not just pipe dreams that will be dreams that will.
You
not
want
be
to direct
fulfilled.
Serious films, don't you?
Well, every
you said
film
Frank
I
Capra,
do is serious,
said,
but it's a comedy.
Oh, okay. Okay.
No, I'm a serious artist, but I love to do comedy.
A book in your life, Stella, coming out with?
Yes.
Everybody, welcome back to Looking at Hollywood, starring our host Skippy Lowe. Today we have a talent extraordinaire, an international film star. We have the great, the one and only Mr. Cesar Romero. And this gives me my opportunity to finally thank him for all the wonderful things he's created that I've been able to enjoy. I mean, without Cesar Romero, I never would have been able to have a Caesar salad. Without Cesar Romero, I never would have been able to stay at Caesar's palace. And without Cesar Romero, we never would have had Sid Caesar. So why don't we have some champagne with Cesar and Skippy?
Cesar, you were telling me before you went to prep school. Your family sent you to a prep school?
Yes, I went to collegiate school in New York.
Right.
Riverdale Country School first, and then collegiate school.
Uh-huh.
But my father had lost everything in the sugar market crash, so when I didn't go to college, but he got me a job at the National City Bank.
Ah.
In Wall Street, and uh-huh. I hated it, you know.
Did you really?
Oh, yes.
Is that where Cesar Romero became a ballroom dancer then?
No, I was always a good dancer. I was always a great dancer as a kid.
Uh-huh.
My Lord, yes.
Uh-huh.
I started dancing when I was 5 years old.
Really?
I learned how to dance with the cook in the kitchen. We had a Puerto Rican cook we had for years. She used to love to dance. She used to dance me around the kitchen.
Uh-huh.
But I didn't... I was on that list, and I went to all the dead parties in New York, you
right.
know. And I had a friend of mine, Elizabeth Higgins, who was a beautiful dancer, and she wanted to dance professionally, and she had the approval of her family.
Right.
And she said to me one day, she said, let's you and I be a dance team. We can work in all those wonderful nightclubs that existed in New York in those days.
Right.
So I said, fine, you know, because dancing was fun for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to get together with Liz at night after I finished working at the bank.
Right.
And then one day she said, look, how much money are you making at the bank? Well, I was only making $17.50 a week. And I paid $7.50 for my room, and I lived on the other $10. You could do that in New York in those days, you know.
Uh-huh.
This is back in 1926. And my family were living in New Jersey. They didn't know what I was up to. So I didn't want to say I'm only making $17.50 a week. So I said, I'm making $25 a week.
Uh-huh.
And she said, well, if you quit your job, I'll pay your salary so we can work all day and rehearse all day and go out and give some auditions.
Uh-huh.
I said, fine. So I quit my job and I got a big raise in salary right off the bat. And we went out and gave auditions and we got a job in a musical comedy called Lady Do.
Lady Do.
Lady Do. The star of the show was a female impersonator.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
do you remember the name of that female impersonator? Because it was very rare those days.
He was known as the Creole Fashion Plate.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, I remember that.
Yeah.
That's an old fashion.
He and... what was his real name, dear? Carl Norman.
Carl Norman. Carol
Norman.
Uh-huh.
Carol Norman.
Uh-huh.
He was a big star in those
right,
days.
Exactly.
So that's what started us off, and I danced for the next 4 years with her
uh-huh.
and other partners.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got a call from an agent, Chamberlain Brown.
Right.
You know, he handled all the big people in the theater in those
Broadway
days.
Broadway stars,
oh,
all
yes.
that. Yes, of course.
And he said, do you think you can play the lead in Strictly Dishonorable? Well, I, you know, what could I lose? I said, sure. You
uh-huh.
know, I never played
uh-huh.
a part. And he got me an appointment with Chamberlain Brown and Antoinette Perry.
Right.
You know, the one, the Tony Awards, the name for her. You know?
Right.
And they said, well, what have you done? And I said a few lies, you know. And they said, well, you come back tomorrow and read for us.
Uh-huh.
Well, I'd seen the play, and I went and saw it again that night.
Right.
And when I went back the next day, I gave as good an imitation of Carminati, because I never took my eyes off him, you know.
Uh-huh.
And I guess it was pretty good, because they signed me to a run-of-the-play contract. And I played, I did Strictly Dishonorable on the road for a year.
And never studied acting?
No.
Never
Cesar studied
anything. Never did study?
No.
Even now, today, even when you were a thint and all as an actor, never took a lesson?
No.
Just being yourself?
Well, that happens to a lot of people.
It does.
A lot of people have never gone
never
to...
acting schools.
No, never. The girl, my leading lady's understudy
right.
in Strictly Dishonorable was a young girl just starting out on her career, and she went on to become a big star
mm-hmm.
in the theater and in motion pictures. Mm-hmm. Her name was Margaret Sullivan.
Great actress.
Yes.
Great. One of the greatest actresses. Valentino. You and Valentino have so much in common because of the Latin lovers. And the come on, Cesar Romero.
Everybody with a
they
Latin...
They compared you with Valentino.
Well, because
you came to Hollywood, really.
But a Latin name. Anybody with a Latin name... was compared to
no,
to Valentino.
Not just not anyone with a Latin name. You happen to be the tall, elegant, dark swatties.
Yeah, well, I played a lot of mugs and
gangsters. You did gangster films.
Oh, sure.
Tell me about those movies, your gangsters, cowboy movies. You did cowboy films?
Well, not too many cowboy. Well,
you did a couple. Cisco Kid.
The Cisco Kid. I did.
You had a series.
I did six Cisco Kid pictures.
You did six of them?
Oh, yes.
That was a series, like.
Yeah.
Saturday afternoons, I used to see them. My mother used to take me to the theater on Saturday afternoon, Annie. And I used to go see the Cisco Kids.
But I, you know, I did my first picture at MGM.
Was that your first at the MGM?
Yeah, The Thin Man.
The Thin Man
MGM
was your...
MGM brought me out here, you know.
Right.
They saw me in a... Ben Piazza, who was the casting director for MGM, saw me in a play.
Uh-huh.
And he came back and said, I'd like to make a screen test of you. And I did. And the result of that test, they signed me to a contract. But I didn't last with them at all. It was a contract for one picture, option of another picture,
right.
You know, option of 6 months.
Because you were a 20th. Actually, you were a 20th
well,
century
I know,
Fox,
but I was
Caesar.
I was a Universal for 3 years before that.
Oh, how about The Shadow Laughs?
That was
your very first dream?
Well, that was in New York.
Oh, was that in New York?
Oh, that was in New York. I don't consider that at all.
Really?
I was practically an extra in that picture, you know.
Uh-huh.
No, I don't consider that my first picture.
What did you do at Universal? You said you were Universal?
Universal, I played opposite. My first picture at Universal was opposite Fay Wray. In a picture called Cheating Cheaters.
Uh-huh.
And I did Diamond Jim Brady, you
right,
know. With,
right,
And I did a lot of... corny pictures up
no,
there.
You did not do corny pictures.
Armored
you know
car
what you did? You did entertaining pictures. Today, they're not entertaining. They're, those days, look at Caesar. Think, really. Watch the movies today.
Listen, it's very different today. My God, the industry is different.
Like what? Tell
well,
me.
Well, I mean, the studios don't, they don't control.
System. They don't have a system.
Of course not. The studio, most of the production in Hollywood today is television. It's not motion pictures. Motion pictures are done all over the country, all over the world.
Right. I see.
Hollywood is no longer the motion picture capital of the world. That's...
How was it for Cesar Romero when you first arrived here in Hollywood, Cesar? You were young. You were dashing.
It was wonderful. We were all under contract to studios. And everybody knew each other from all the different studios,
right.
You know. It was like a big family.
Uh-huh.
And there was a very definite motion picture colony in those days.
Right.
And within that motion picture colony was a very elegant society. At all the social functions in this town, you'd see every big star would be there. Mary Pickford, Charlie Chaplin, Douglas Fairbanks. I mean, everybody.
Right.
Everybody. There was a social thing in Hollywood. And you know, Mary was the queen, and Marion Davies, the wonderful parties she used
right.
to give. You know, Hearst would come in and have the studio... turn the two tennis courts out of the beach into anything she wanted.
Yes.
A Spanish town, a circus.
Uh-huh.
I mean, those days are gone forever. But I'm so glad that I had all those years because it's so very different now, you know?
Uh-huh.
There's you don't have that feeling of community together,
right.
You know?
But it was glamour. That was
Of course it was glamorous.
People never used to go out without their makeup or their hair. Stars.
And
it was very
important. Everybody was dressed properly.
Right.
At all times.
Never saw jeans.
No.
Ever. Or sneakers.
Sneakers and open shirts.
Yes.
And at openings today, you see people in shirt sleeves and open. Come on.
Movie stars. They wanted to see movie stars. That's what Hollywood was. It was a fantasy land. It was real. It was classy then, wasn't it?
Oh, it sure was.
Cesar Romero, you go out a lot in this town.
Yes,
a lot
I do.
With Civil Brand every night, practically. How do you do this? What is your secret, Caesar?
Well,
you're not a young man, you know.
No,
You're in your what? 80s.
I'm 85.
And he looks marvelous.
80, Annie.
I'll be 84 months.
86. Caesar Romero.
Why, sure.
Getting back to Hollywood.
I've been around a long time.
Yeah, you did a movie I loved at 20th. What happened to 20th? What was your first film at 20th? Because I love that studio.
Well, my first picture at 20th Century Fox was, my first picture was Zanuck.
Zanuck,
well,
yes.
I did three pictures for Zanuck while I was still under contract to Universal.
Oh, really?
He borrowed me. I did Clive of India.
Right.
With Ronald Coleman and Loretta Young.
Mm-hmm.
And I did Cardinal Richelieu. I played opposite Maureen O'Sullivan in it, you know. Caught originally with the star, George Arliss, you know.
Uh-huh.
And then I did Metropolitan with Lawrence
Tibbett,
and I played opposite Virginia Bruce in it, you know.
Wonderful, Lawrence
Tibbett. And Alice Brady.
Uh-huh.
Those were all when Zanuck was making his pictures on the United Artists lot. It was just 20th Century Pictures.
Mm-hmm.
Then he moved to Fox, and it became 20th Century Fox. And I did the first picture under contract, still at Universal.
Right.
I did the picture called Show Them No Mercy. It was the first picture on the Fox lot.
Who was in it?
No big stars. Bruce
Cabot. That was the first film on the lot?
Bruce Cabot, Rochelle Hudson was the girl.
Uh-huh.
Warren Heimer. And, you know, it was a great, wonderful picture. It was one of my favorite pictures.
Why is that your favorite picture?
Because it was a good picture, and it was a damn good role.
Uh-huh.
We were a bunch of kidnappers, you know. In those days, there were a lot of big kidnappings around the country, and it was very timely.
Uh-huh.
But then I did, and I was still under contract to Universal.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Then I did Clive of India. I mean, Wee Willie Winkie.
See, you know, Caesar, I love this lady so much, and I'm sure you do too. You must have great fond memories. Betty Grable.
Oh, yeah.
Well, love Betty Grable. I grew up as a child with her.
I did about 4 or 5 pictures with Betty.
You brought a clip, and I want to show you. I'm going to surprise you with this clip. I love this clip. It's great. I love this movie of Betty Grable and you in this film.
Well,
let's show it.
Give me an opportunity to dance in it.
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, let's see it. Let's see Caesar Romero and Betty Grable.
All right, let's see it.
Come in.
Vicky.
Victor Prince. Why, I thought you were... lovely surprises.
Vicky. I thought so. Time has only succeeded in making you more exquisite.
Thank you. Hi.
Hello, Phoebe. You haven't changed. Vicky Lane in person. Not a facsimile, but the real thing in the flesh.
And a couple of pounds too much of it. That was always one good thing about dancing with you, Victor. You were so strenuous, you kept me down to 110.
That wasn't the only good thing about dancing with me, I hope. Couldn't we have a little chat?
5 minutes, Miss Lane.
Oh, thanks, Tommy. I'm sorry, Victor, but the show must go on. Phoebe, will you tell Dan I'd like to see him before our number?
Oh, Victor.
Gosh, it's been almost a year, hasn't it?
A year of thinking of you, Vicky. No, there wasn't a day of my tour that I didn't miss you. I kept seeing your reflection in Louisiana bayous and Arizona sunsets. No one could ever replace you, Vicky. There'll never be another Victor in Victoria. Come back, Vicky.
Oh, that's nice, Victor, but...
I've got the finest hotels in the country lined up, all of them waiting for you. And of course, you know, my heart is waiting, too.
Well, I've got 2,000 people waiting for me, so I...
Oh, Vicky, I've got a new step. I call it the Victor.
Oh,
it goes like
Victor.
This.
Am I late? See, I'm late. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Oh, God, Caesar, that's so good. Betty Grable, working with Betty Grable. Beautiful lady. Beautiful. Just beautiful.
She was wonderful to work with.
Was she?
Yeah, she had a lovely sense of humor. She was a lot of fun to work
with. Harry James was in this?
Yes, that's where...
John Payne.
Oh, Carmen Miranda.
Carmen Miranda.
Charlotte Greenwood.
Charlotte Greenwood, the ladies.
Edward Everett Horton.
Uh-huh.
It was a very great cast.
Carmen Miranda. Must have been very close, you guys. Latin and carrying on. Was she crazy and there were a lot on the set?
No, she really wasn't in real life.
Really?
You know, but she worked that way, you know. She murdered the English language.
Uh-huh.
And when she started, you know, she was very new and she was a novelty, you know. People had never seen anybody like that before.
Big platforms like that?
That's right.
Tiny little girl.
So she was very popular there for a while.
Uh-huh.
But towards the end, Carmen had trouble, you know, because she never changed.
Same thing.
She never changed. She was still singing. You know, and by that time, after a few years of that, it was no novelty anymore.
Right.
So towards the end, you know, she... having a hard time.
Did Betty Grable meet Harry James? Were they married at that time? Or
no,
did they meet on the set and they fell in love and they got married?
No, they weren't married at that
time. They weren't?
No, indeed.
How did
That's what started that.
That's what started?
Certainly.
Springtime in the Rockies.
Springtime in the Rockies.
John Payne. Loved this guy. Great.
Yeah.
He never studied acting. This guy was just an ordinary good actor. Tell me about John Payne. I really liked him.
Well, John, I remember John when he first started in the business. He and Lee Bowman were roommates. They had an apartment next to mine, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And he started, I think, John started, he was under contract to Goldwyn,
Goldwyn,
I think.
Sammy Goldwyn, yes.
Yeah,
yes, he was.
When he started. But he was a very popular leading man, you know.
Loved motorcycles, I know that.
20th Century Fox.
Motorcycles, he loved.
Well...
Yeah, he did. He was one of the Hollywood early motorcycle guys before Marlon Brando and Jimmy Dean and all those guys.
Oh, I don't remember
no,
that.
No, you don't? I read something about it. Tales of Manhattan. Come on, Cesar Romero. My favorite film.
Your favorite film?
One of my favorites. It's
God,
a great film.
Everybody Tales. Under the sun was in that picture.
I know it.
It was a story of a suit of tails.
It's wonderful.
But I was in the episode with Ginger Rogers and Henry Fonda.
Fonda. Working with Henry Fonda.
That's the only time I worked with Henry. I never worked with him.
Never before.
In all the years we were at Fox together.
Is that the first time? You used to see him on the lot a lot.
And I never worked with Ginger either until then.
Cesar Romero, tell me about the commissary. That 20th Century Fox commissary, Annie. It was wonderful. I used to go there when I was a kid. Because I did a movie there years ago for Henry King. I can't remember the name of it.
Yeah.
But I used to go to the commissary. That commissary was the greatest in Hollywood. Tell me about that.
Well, you'd go there for lunch. It was all, you know, you knew where you were going. We had lunch in the little room on the side
but
there.
But the people, the stars,
everybody,
my God.
But everybody under the sun would have lunch there.
Right, right.
You saw everybody you knew.
Uh-huh.
It was, I mean, you took it.
All day working. Going out at night. You had to go out, and you had to go to Searles,
no.
McCombell's.
Yeah, but when we were working in pictures, we didn't go out
you
at
didn't
night.
Go out?
Oh, no. No, no, no. I'm sorry, I can't go out. I'm working tomorrow.
I see. How was Searles those days, and McCombell's, and...
Well, the greatest supper club we had in this town was the Trocadero.
Trocadero.
That was the place.
Is that where... Yes, that was the greatest. Who's some of the stars performed there? They had a...
Well, you know, on Sundays, they had... sort of a, not a contest, but young performers come up there, you know. One of them was Ann Miller.
Was she there? That's how she got discovered?
Oh, well, yes.
Did Ann Miller get discovered to one of those places?
Yeah, she was, I used to see Ann rehearsing in the rehearsal hall at, I forget, who were the producers, big producers for shows? In movie houses.
I don't know. It doesn't matter.
And I saw her rehearsing in one of the rehearsal halls there, this young girl, you know. And then the next time I saw her, she was hoofing it at the Trocadero.
Tell me.
That was a great club, you know. It was the best supper club we ever had in this town.
Tails. You used to go in tuxedos. People used to dress
really?
In tuxedos, not suits. And tuxedos in the evening. Wasn't it? That's the way to go. To go to dinner.
And we used to have a lot of affairs here at Tao. You'd be in white tie. White tie and tails. I remember the ball that Carol Lombard was the chairperson for it. And she decreed that all the women would wear white and the men would wear white tie and tails. And it was beautiful. All the women were dressed in white except one. Norma Shearer came in bright red from head to foot. Nobody was going to tell her what to wear.
I like it.
Cesar Romero, what's the biggest lesson you have learned in life? Because you're 80-some years old. God, what has been the biggest lesson for Cesar Romero?
My lesson has been to have tolerance for people and respect for people.
I like that. Tolerance.
Tolerance and respect.
That's nice. Have you ever turned a part down that you have regretted later?
Oh, no.
That you have regretted later?
No.
No?
No. But I took, I took one, I think, suspension years ago. And then I saw, I said, this is for the birds, you know. Because you're off salary and they attach that time to your contract.
Right, right.
So I said, this is no good. So I never took a, I did what the studio told me to do. And I played, You know, when they assigned me to a picture, I did it, and I did the best job I could for them, and I had a long, long
How many films has Cesar Romero has done?
Over 100? Over 100, yes.
One of my favorites here, another one of my favorites, Captain from Castile. I'm going to Tyrone Power in you.
Yes.
Let's show this clip.
Well, he was one of my dearest friends.
We're going to talk to him. Yes, I know.
You know.
Let's show this clip, Captain from Castile. Cesar Romero.
Your name?
Pedro de Vargas.
Signed here. Where from?
Jaén, Spain.
Are you a relative of Francisco de Vargas?
His son, sir.
I'm Hernán Cortés. Our fathers were friends. Though mine never reached the eminence of yours. Your illustrious father as well?
When I last saw him, sir.
I'm delighted to have you join us in this venture. If you've the spirit and merit of your father, you'll prove worthy of promotion and a command.
Thank you, Captain.
A gentleman, a good omen, the son of Francisco de Vargas joins our company. This is Corio, the first officer of the Gallega. This is Captain Sandoval.
Captain.
Senor de...
Captain Alvarado.
Welcome to the expedition.
Thank you, Captain.
And this is our chaplain, Father Bartolome de Olmedo.
Father.
Fathers.
And here we have Senor Juan Escudero and Senor Diego Sermano.
Señores.
These two gentlemen are representatives of His Excellency the Governor of Cuba. They came from Santiago at the last moment to relieve me of my command. But I believe I've successfully convinced them that I am going to be the captain of this company, or there isn't going to be any captain. Hey, gentlemen? And who might you be?
Titana Perez, sir.
One of our ladies, eh? We've quite a few in the army already. Some married and some in hopes of it. You know, sometimes I think you women will end up with more gold out of this one way or the other than any of us. You wish to inscribe your name in the roll of the company, little one?
Oh, yes, sir. Thank you, my lord.
Oh. I can't believe it. Jean Peters. Tyrone Power.
That was Jean's first picture.
Was that Jean Peters' first?
Yes.
She was gorgeous.
Her first picture.
She was married to Howard Hughes.
Well, she wasn't married then.
Yeah, no, but this was after.
Well, quite a time after, yeah. Because she married somebody else first, you
Who
know.
Who did she marry first?
I forget, but...
Doesn't matter.
She was divorced, and then she married Howard.
Tyrone Power, best of friends. He was a flyer. He was a great guy. You guys were close together. You were in the flyers together.
He was my very, very close friend. I had one of the best experiences of my life with Tyrone. He was a flyer, you know,
right.
In the war, in the Marine Corps.
Right.
And I was in the Coast Guard. I was in an attack transport out in the Pacific. And we both got out of the service at the same time.
Right.
And we reported back to the studio. And they sent us on this goodwill trip. Right. And the studio provided us with a twin-engine Beechcraft, and Ty did all the flying. And we flew down through Mexico, we hit every country in Central America, and we circled all of South America. We went down the western coast, down to Santiago, Chile, uh-huh. through the pass to Buenos Aires,
right.
up over the Guianas, the West Indies, mm-hmm. Havana, New York, California. We were 10 weeks on this trip. It's a wonderful experience. We met practically all the presidents mm-hmm. of the countries
right.
that we visited. Because the first person we had to meet was the American ambassador. Mm-hmm. And the ambassador introduced us to the president either at luncheon or a meeting or cocktails
right.
or dinner. And the most interesting ones were when we had lunch with Perón and Evita.
Oh, did you?
In the palace uh-huh. at Buenos Aires.
Uh-huh.
She was a charming
was
woman.
Was she really?
Oh, yes. Uh-huh. She didn't speak English.
Uh-huh.
So I interpreted for her, you know, uh-huh. because... And Perón didn't speak English
right.
either.
Right.
And she was very amusing. She'd sit there, she'd say to me, she said, why do the people in your country call my husband a dictator? She said, he's not a dictator, he's a patriot. Isn't that right, Juan? You're a patriot, aren't you? And Perón said, si, yes. she would say things uh-huh. like, you're so fortunate because the people in your country
uh-huh.
Respect and love their artists.
Right.
She said, here in my country, they spit at them. She said, I know because I was an artist.
Caesar, Tyrone Power, what a classy guy.
Oh, yes.
He was classy, wasn't
yes,
he?
Yes, he was. And he loved his work. He loved his work. He loved being a star.
Uh-huh.
He loved it.
He did enjoy being a star.
Oh, yes, he loved every minute of it.
He married Linda Christian. Were you at the wedding in Rome when they got married?
No. He married in Rome.
They got married, and I interviewed Linda, and she was telling me about the greatest marriage ever in
Rome. Yeah, well.
They love him all over the world.
Yes, well.
He had to die in Spain, his favorite place, where he loved. Isn't that in Madrid? And, you know, I was in Madrid at the time when this happened. And,
oh, really?
Yeah, and I was terrified. My heart just broke. Believe in fate?
I did the eulogy at his funeral.
Did you really?
Yes, and I said, I'll never do this again, ever.
Tore your heart.
Oh,
he was your best friend.
And he'd been dead about a week, you know, and he just looked awful in that casket. And he was married to...
Annabella?
No. Annabella was his first wife.
His first wife, yes.
You know.
She was great, though.
He should never have divorced her. She divorced him.
I heard this.
Sure.
Tell me about, do you believe in fate, Caesar?
Well, I guess so.
Yeah. Girl, you know, you keep going on, Caesar. Let's face it, you go out every night. What is Caesar Romero's secret? What do you eat? I have to know. What is your secret? Because you look so great.
No.
Your hair, everything, your skin.
There's no secret.
It's the genes.
Just trust your luck. It's your genes. I think that has a lot to do with it.
I think the way you're peaceful, you think peacefully. What is the day like for you? What time of the day you get up, Caesar Romero?
I get up around 7 o'clock in the morning.
Okay. Do you walk?
No, I don't walk. I can't walk long distances. I have a problem with my back and my hips. You know, I have a few problems that I have to take
What would you think is the greatest achievement that you have achieved in your life, Caesar?
My greatest achievement was to be able to take care of my family.
That's right.
I took care of my mother and my father and my sisters and my kid brother, and I put them through college.
That was my greatest achievement.
To take care of my family, and I took care of them. I had my mother and my father under my roof to the day they died.
Really, Caesar?
Wow.
You take good care of them. That is a secret. That's the secret of his life. See how wonderful. Caesar Romero, over 100-some films, Hollywood. Oh, come on. I mean, looking back. Any regrets about anything in life?
No.
You have no regrets about anything?
I have been so lucky. I wouldn't dare. No, indeed. I've had a lot of great luck in my life.
You still see all your friends in Hollywood. You still meet them at parties, all these wonderful people.
My group of friends have changed a great deal through the years, you know. People have changed. I see a great deal of Sybil Brand, as you know, and I see a lot of Anne Jeffries.
Yeah. You go out a lot with her.
And Henny Backus. And Lee Minnelli. Those are the group that I sort of...
Tell me about Lee Minnelli. She's a nice lady. I've always wanted to really talk to her. I've spoken to her several times.
Well,
what a nice lady.
Yeah, she is. She is.
You surround yourself with nice people, Caesar.
I'm
sitting here saying, God, you mentioned these wonderful names, Sybil Brand, Lee Minnelli. You surround yourself with...
Sybil Brand is a unique person in this town.
Again, although it's uncertain what Louis B. Mayer might have thought of him, today's guest has impressed countless theater, movie, and TV audiences with his many memorable performances. One of the stars of Showtime's new series, The Boys, he's Alan Garfield. And now, here's your impressive man of the half hour, Skippy Lowe.
Alan Garfield.
Hi, Skip.
How are you?
Okay.
Good God. New Jersey?
Newark? Yeah, born and raised in New Jersey.
Tough place. Isn't it growing up?
I never thought so. It was. It was. I never thought so. I do remember getting beaten up by the barbarians coming home from Temple B'nai Abraham.
Uh-huh.
I do remember that. So it was tough in that sense, yeah.
Tell me something.
I became a Golden Gloves boxer.
You were a boxer?
Yes.
That's right.
I thought that was a way of keeping the gangs off me, and it was,
And then you became a newspaper
I was a journalist for 10 years. I started off as a copy boy for the still-existing Newark Star-Ledger, which is the big daily paper in Newark. And then I advanced to sports writer.
Uh-huh.
And that was at the same time where I was boxing Golden Gloves and also doing sports writing.
Right.
And then I became managing editor of a newspaper in Linden, New Jersey.
Uh-huh.
And then...
Linden, New Jersey. I worked a club there.
Did you?
In Linden, New Jersey.
You remember Linden, New Jersey?
Yes. I took a bus out of Port Authority and went to Linden,
Absolutely.
New Jersey.
Probably the number 42 or something.
Go ahead.
And Linden, New Jersey was a big political hotbed, too.
Right.
So I covered politics and humor. I remember being probably the only journalist in the late 50s and early 60s that wrote articles supporting people going to see Lenny Bruce. He was my idol.
Yeah. Lenny Bruce was your idol?
Oh, you'd better believe it, indeed. Uh-huh. The first time I ever saw Lenny was at a little club called The Den in the Hotel Duane in New York.
Right.
And I actually went to see a singer who I loved, Jackie Paris.
Uh-huh.
And I saw Lenny Bruce for the first time. Uh-huh. I think it was it had to have been like in 59, I believe.
Right.
When things were good, you know?
But did you have in your mind at that time you wanted to be an actor?
No.
Come on. Because you're...
Well, by that time I did, except I didn't up until 1957.
Right.
And what happened with me, I was a journalist through and through. I love creative writing. I love sports writing. Uh-huh. I thought I was either going to be the first boxer journalist, you know, like a Hemingway character.
Yeah, right.
I'd be like the Jewish Hemingway, right? I'd box and also write about boxing.
Right,
you know?
Right.
And then what happened, Skip? There were two movies that like profoundly influenced my life. One, I saw a movie based on a Broadway play called Tomorrow the World.
Oops.
And there was another skip in that. A child actor named Skippy Hohmeyer,
right,
who played a brainwashed youngster whose father had been executed by the Nazis.
Right.
He was a German patriot who stood up against the Third Reich.
Uh-huh.
And when he was executed, his son was brainwashed and brought up to believe that his father was a traitor.
Right.
I saw that movie with Frederick March and Skippy Hohmeyer when I was in my senior year in high school.
Right.
And in one click, it said to me, how I could take journalism and express it very, very personally as an actor.
Right.
And what I did was I adapted a part of the play, a good long section. I directed it. I cast it. I played the German boy and performed it without any training or fanfare or anything prior to that.
Right.
I stepped out as an actor, performed it twice before 2,000 people in two assemblies.
Really?
And the response to that confirmed that I was, for me, in my gut, that I was going to be an actor.
Uh-huh.
And also, but I should tell you that for the next 10 years, from 16 to 26,
right,
I still was a journalist.
Journalist? Actor journalist?
Well, I was studying acting at night in New York.
With Actor
with a
Studio?
Before I got taken into the Actor Studio, a man who, God bless him, is still teaching in New York, Anthony Menino. Mm-hmm. I studied for 2 years with Anthony Menino, and then I wrote a play before anybody knew I was an actor. I wrote a play, a dark comedy that got me taken into the Actor's Studio.
Right.
The actor William Devane was head of the playwrights unit at the time in New York. He saw the play, he read the play, and he said, I'm bringing you in here, make some waves. Mm-hmm. And so I got taken in as a writer and as a beginning director before even being passing my audition as an actor.
Uh-huh.
And so the Actor's Studio in New York in the late 60s.
Strasburg.
It came under the aegis of Strasburg, Klerman,
uh-huh,
the most passionate people
right
in the world. You know, Lee and Harold were very, very profound influences on I feel, my character,
right,
my fiber as somebody in the arts.
Do you call yourself a method actor?
Yeah, unabashedly. Unabashedly, but not in the sense... not in the sense where I see a lot of so-called method actors from from years ago, like,
right,
who studied like in with Lee in New York.
Right. And go ahead.
Who remained classroom actors. Do you know what I mean?
Never became anything but.
They were cultivated inadvertently, right, or by design in order to be perfect classroom actors,
yes,
but being terrified about going into the real world.
Yeah.
And that's not why I became an actor.
Right.
I became an actor in order to be trained by the masters, which I was at the Actors Studio.
Uh-huh.
But to take that, from the moment I stepped foot in the Actors Studio, as anybody will tell you, I audaciously stepped out and said who I was, for
yes,
better or for worse.
Yes.
And I put my stamp on things as an actor, mm-hmm, and as a director.
Uh-huh.
And that's also after, this is my 24th year as an actor.
24?
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
First
I feel like a kid.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like a kid. And I'm 49 years old.
Mm-hmm.
I feel 20 years younger than I did when I started acting,
right,
over 20
right,
years ago. And also what gives me a lot of nachas, goodness,
uh-huh,
right, is I also teach acting and directing in Hollywood throughout the year.
Uh-huh.
So I have my own acting emporium,
right,
called the Actor Shelter, where I teach and train actors and directors,
uh-huh,
and
uh-huh,
screenwriters in order to give back what I've been blessed with.
See,
for almost a quarter
that's
of a century.
Alan. First film, I got to get.
The
Cry,
it wasn't Cry Uncle.
Why is it?
No, well, Cry Uncle was my first lead in a film.
Okay.
Cry Uncle is where I, as
yeah,
you may know,
uh-huh,
play this horny, panty-clad or shorts-clad private eye,
right,
who thinks he's the greatest cocksman in the world,
uh-huh,
and almost keeps getting killed after getting involved with all his femme fatales.
Uh-huh.
And I'm at this beach balloon weight of God uh-huh knows what, even
right,
maybe my Brinks weight of over,
right,
oh, it's a door. Anyhow, John Avildsen, who later directed
right
Rocky and who previously directed Joe,
uh-huh,
cast me in that film. And I got rave reviews in
certainly
Time
did
magazine,
uh-huh,
but it's like one of a kind.
Uh-huh.
It's like a cult classic of
uh-huh,
it's like a humorous, raunchy takeoff on the old Mickey Spillane hard-nosed
right,
character.
Right.
But the first film, if
what
truth be told,
go ahead.
While I was a theater actor, the first film I ever got cast in
uh-huh
was a film called Orgy Girls.
Orgy Girls.
There was no orgy in it. There was no orgy. It was originally titled Girls of the City.
Right.
And it had, I remember the producer. His name was Leonard Kurtman,
uh-huh,
and the director was Robert Canton. I had never done any film,
uh-huh,
and it was called Girls of the City.
Uh-huh.
It was about the misadventures of young women coming to New York to find their fame and fortune. And then it wound up on 42nd Street called Orgy Girls.
I know it.
I play this photographer
right
who tries to help a down-and-out model.
Right, right.
That was my first film
yeah, right,
of people coming up to me and congratulating me on a film called Orgy Girls.
That's the first time I've remembered you.
I don't believe
film
it.
Yes, I do.
Are you kidding
I certainly
me?
Certainly did. I was
you
in New York. Yeah, I saw that film. It was a great
And it was a black and white film.
But,
yes,
go ahead. But,
what?
The movie that I love was the wonderful with the Conversations.
Oh, that's my favorite.
Is it?
I swear to God.
It's my favorite, too.
That, of all, you know, I've done 44 motion pictures.
44?
Absolutely.
Conversations
of all the films that
was
I've
the
ever
best
done,
film.
There are some films that I would put in my personal time capsule.
Yes.
One is The Stuntman that Richard Rush did.
Stuntman.
One is The State of Things, where Wim Wenders let me write and perform
yeah
and create my own role
uh-huh
in the last half of the film. One would be The Candidate that I did with Redford.
Redford, The Candidate. That was great.
One would certainly be the most demanding role I ever had to do was in Bob Altman's Nashville.
Uh-huh.
That was incredibly painful and beautiful to do. And
what makes it so painful?
Well, because
and
Bob
beautiful
gave me
what
such rein
right
and gave me such, allowed me, he had the courage to allow me to take the responsibility
yes
in every respect for my character. And that character had a gut-wrenching job to do of being a overbearing, loving,
uh-huh
bullying manager of a famous country and western singer.
Right.
It took a lot of love and a lot of pain to really search. When you ask if I'm a method actor,
yes, you
in
are
that regard, I searched my gut, man, and Ronnie Blakely, who played
uh-huh
my wife,
uh-huh,
and I really went through a lot of love and a lot of pain
uh-huh
in getting to the souls of those two
right
characters. But The Conversation,
uh-huh,
of all the films, it's the one that I unequivocally respect the most that I've ever done. It said more about America
yes
and the eavesdropping menace in our society.
Uh-huh.
It was in my estimation, it was Francis Ford Coppola.
Coppola's
at the top
best,
of his game,
best,
the at best. The pinnacle of his yes, game, yeah. at the most personal of his game.
Yeah.
And it was also, unfortunately, a bastard child of Paramount Studios, because Paramount did not want him to do the conversation after Godfather, the original
right,
Godfather.
Right.
They wanted Francis to go right on and do Godfather
gangsters,
too.
Yes, of course.
And the conversation was originally written for Brando to do, but because Brando had a falling out with the Paramount executives
right.
and vice versa,
right.
which resulted in Brando not being in Godfather 2,
right.
it worked out that Gene Hackman played the Harry Call, the wiretapper, uh-huh. and as far as I'm concerned, it is the most definitive, most uh-huh. incredible performance of Gene Hackman's life. It is. I think it's a milestone performance.
Yes, yes.
But the film is a milestone film.
Oh, it's a great movie.
Just, we went to
yeah.
Cannes Film Festival uh-huh. in 73, uh-huh. and we won the Cannes Film Festival. 74. We won the Cannes Film Festival uh-huh. with the conversation in 74.
It was great.
Yeah.
I'm looking at you, Alan Garfield.
Yeah.
Method acting.
Yes.
You say you get right deep down into your soul, method actors.
Yeah. In both comedy and drama, too.
Both. That's yeah. being truthful and honest. What does Alan Garfield get into method and down his soul? Do you find something when you act that you really bring the truth out or that you have learned or experienced and then you bring that into the truth of that dialogue?
I think a lot of things that I hook into as a writer, as a director, and especially as an actor, are really hooked into my childhood.
That's
in other words, even though there are things that bombard us each and every day in Hollywood that impact us in our everyday
right.
lives, the things that I draw upon are usually things that took place a long time ago that have parallels to today.
Right.
In other words, how I was brought up, how I was either loved or overprotected
uh-huh.
or over-sheltered or things that have to do with the dark side of growing up
right.
and the desire to bust out
yes, yes.
and to break free against all odds, you know, against loving but overbearing parents
yes.
who wanted the best for you, but in so doing sometimes the best for you also meant imprisoning your emotions
yes.
and imprisoning your childhood freedoms. So a lot of the things that I draw upon in characters
yes.
where I always try, even if it's the most menacing
yes.
or even barbarous of characters, I
yes.
try to find the hook to what got him to a point where something snapped
uh-huh.
or also what is the whimsical side?
Yes.
What is the absurd side to this hair-raising character, you know?
Yeah. Do the directors give you freedom? When you're doing the scene, they?
I would say directors who cast me
yes.
have
give you
intelligently
that
said, we know what we've got here, and we're gonna let him go,
go on. Yeah.
But we're gonna be there to help him to keep him on course.
Uh-huh.
So the best of directors, like Francis,
right.
like Altman, like Wenders, are intuitively, like Richard Rush
right.
And Michael Ritchie, are intuitively there to uncannily, almost unspokenly sometimes, keep you on course and also hook you in.
Uh-huh.
If you're drifting away from
right.
each of your collective courses, they will say a word. They will uh-huh. say a thing that has to do with a vision. Mm-hmm. One of the finest directors, oddly enough, that I've ever worked with is an actor, Stacy Keach, who directed me on television
right.
of Incident at Vichy, the
right.
Arthur Miller piece.
Right.
And Stacy really, really knew how to talk unobtrusively, succinctly, and so that the actor was able to go back into the acting without it being an intrusion.
Right.
That's what I try to do when I'm directing. It's also the best of worlds when a director has the vision
uh-huh.
and the sensitivity uh-huh. To do that.
I got to ask you about stuntman.
Yes.
Stuntman, Peter
yes.
O'Toole.
Oh, wow.
God, what a great actor. Working with such great, you've worked with some great actors.
Yeah, I would say.
But you know something?
I would say so.
Tell me about Peter O'Toole, with Peter O'Toole.
It was like, you know the relationship we had in the film, it was like Don Quixote and Sancho Panza.
Right.
And it's proof positive. You know, it really, when you ask about the Actor's Studio, which is my rock bed in terms
of
training.
Course.
But you know something, the bottom line is, as blessed as I was, to be then and now, a life member of an organization like the Actors Studio. The bottom line is, it really doesn't matter where you study as much as what gets put out there.
Yes.
In other words, here Peter O'Toole, from his incredible vast training, me from my training, and we just gelled.
Right.
We were like from two different continents on the same planet.
Right.
And that's it. You know, we're on the same planet.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't.
You understand.
It doesn't, yeah. I mean, you know.
I went to see Shelley Winters.
Yes.
I observed her class at the Actors Studio last week.
Yes.
Here's a lady who's a great actress.
Yes.
She gives her soul, her whole being, 3 hours of teaching students.
Yeah.
For nothing.
Yeah.
For nothing.
I know. Well,
she doesn't get paid.
It's not for nothing. You know what it
is. But she's doing it.
There's a slogan. There's a slogan that says, in order to keep what you've got, you've got to give it away. And I believe in that. In other words, whether it's by design or just by intuition, you give away what you've got and it keeps coming back to you.
Yes.
Shelley loves actors.
She loves it.
And loves giving to actors. And I don't care how many people may watch a talk show like the Carson Show and find her in a ditzy frame of mind.
Right.
That woman is brilliant. She is disciplined.
Disciplined.
She's one of the most disciplined actresses I've ever seen on stage.
In order to be a good actor, you've got to be disciplined. You got to work at it.
Absolutely.
She says, even if you go on the garage, do it.
Absolutely.
That's the only way to be an actor. Is that
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. The only way to be an actor is to act.
You've got
to act.
Yeah.
You know, people wait. Wait.
And work at it. You've got to work at it.
One of my students asked me for a definition of success.
Yes.
And I said, the best definition I heard of success did not even come from somebody talking about acting, but it was a business person telling me, a businessman saying that a definition of success for him is success is when opportunity meets preparation.
That's right.
You know? You don't wait to be discovered. Notwithstanding the fact that we all know that people... In this beautiful, absurd land that we're living in right here in town, get discovered on elevators or in washrooms or at soda fountains. The fact is, if one is talking about a life's work in acting, as opposed to a flash in the pan, or as opposed to a one and out, if one is talking about a life's work dedicated to acting, which is a gorgeous art form, then we're talking about staying hooked into the study.
Yes.
I'm a perennial student, even though I am out there all the time working. My students see me working.
Don't you hate the word when you say it's a business? I hate that word. It's not a business. It's an art. Artistic things is not a business.
Well, you know something,
Alan,
I used to be insulted when anybody also called it a business.
I hate it.
But do you know something, Skip? I think it's also incumbent. It's also incumbent on the actor. If he is to be out there in this real harsh, artistic,
beautiful world,
to also not be oblivious of the business side, not to the extent that it overrides the artistic bent, but to be so isolated in just the artistic bent and removed from the business side, you can have an actor with a multitude of talent wind up, by his own inadvertency, be overlooked professionally if he is not tuned in to some aspects of the business world. He's got to be aware of how people function out there.
You know who that is?
Well, otherwise,
Barbara Streisand. She is totally a business professional, great artist, everything.
Yes,
that's
and consummately. But it because this town, even more so than New York, this town, if you do not keep your head on straight.
Yeah,
and we all know. Geez, I've worked with geniuses, Skip.
Yeah,
geniuses who are no longer amongst the living. I worked with Belushi in Continental Divide. Mm-hmm. I did the only dramatic piece that Freddie Prinze ever did on television, a movie of the week.
Did you?
And those fellas are no longer with us, not because their talent ran out, but because their time ran out because of substances. Pardon me, and also because of not having a serenity in their life that allowed them to be at peace with themselves.
Yes.
And some of that has to do with not being able to handle the business side sanely, of it getting to us. I remember when I first came out here to California 18 years ago, I remember a hit series. My agent at the time represented an actor on a hit series called Alias Smith and Jones, Pete Duell. Who committed suicide.
Yes.
He wanted so badly to get off a series, and they told him he couldn't. And the poor
He didn't felt, want it, huh?
Well, he didn't want any more of it. Who knows what goes into the ingredients?
Yes, right.
But the fact is, the most important thing is to combine having love in your life, mm-hmm. having a sense of perspective.
Yes, yes.
That it can be tomorrow, but it doesn't mean that there's no harm, God knows, in planning for the future. As long as you have a perspective about what's going on today.
Yes.
And also something in terms of a perspective of the world
around you,
so that the most well-rounded actor should also be aware of what's going on in the news, God knows.
Yes, yes.
Do you know? I mean, hopefully.
Alan, I'm looking at you.
What?
You know something.
This like baby
a,
face?
No, you're like a pussycat. You know, yes, I do. Because you know why? You are a chameleon actor. We just lost a great chameleon actor.
Oh, God. Jesus.
One of the greatest, Laurence Olivier.
My God.
What a chameleon. Oh, yeah. What a fantastic actor.
Yeah. My favorite performance to this day is The Entertainer.
Entertainer.
Oh, God.
Why is it your favorite performance of
I think that role, I don't know whether Sir Lawrence, wherever he is, would agree, but I think that role, in the pure sense, touched every nerve ending of that man's... Yeah. Chords, the things that made him an actor, the things that inspired him to be an actor, and also the dark, ugly, bitter side, in addition to the robust side, it really contemporized him for me in a way that
you are one of the great American character actors.
Thank you.
One of the best.
Thank you.
One of the best.
Thank you.
Did a thing called Dark on the Dark Side.
Tales from the Dark Side. Tales from the Dark Side.
Who directed that?
A dear friend of mine, T.J. Castronova.
I'd like to see that. Could I show a clip from it?
Yeah, we brought a clip from it.
Okay, I love
it. Should I tell you that I play the devil in three different disguises?
A devil in three?
Three different characters.
Good.
And my dog, Manziana, who's not in the studio at the moment, plays my devil dog in the show, too.
Okay. And, can we see it?
Yeah,
I'd love
sure.
to see it. Roll
I love
would
it.
Would you? Roll it.
Come in.
Hey.
How'd it go, kid?
Don't even ask.
That bad, huh?
Sorry. I give them art, and they give me back crap.
The money was in the limousine, not on the screen, eh?
Yeah. What do those guys know about making movies, anyway? Just a bunch of accountants who wouldn't know a jump cut if it bit them in the bottom line. Just once, I'd like to have the power. Just once.
I'm gonna get you that power.
Come on, Donald. You got me that deal somehow. What are you gonna do, make me a movie mogul?
Yep.
Don't be ridiculous. Who do you think you are?
I'm the devil.
Yeah? Where's your horns and tail?
Tom, please. That's in cartoons. I'm the real stuff. And the devil can do anything he wants. For a price.
What, 10%?
More.
20? You talking about my soul? You're crazy, Donald. You're flipped out. You've been watching too much bad TV.
I like bad TV. You think it over, kid. I mean, like I said before, it's not the movie. It's the deal, right? And that's the deal.
Okay, Donald, so you say you're the... I thought you said you didn't have a tail.
I lied.
Oh boy, I tell you, Alan, you must have fun playing the devil.
Oh yeah, it was beautiful.
Alan, I want to tell you something. You worked with Eddie Murphy.
And
Beverly Hills Cop 2?
Yep, this I played the
Beverly Hills
the bombastic
Cop
new police chief.
You played the new chief. Bombastic.
Harold Lutz.
That's good. How working with Eddie Murphy?
Yeah, quite an honor, and I don't use that word lightly because
really?
he is so gifted. and so giving.
I like the show.
And so outrageous. I mean, even when you think one of Eddie's outrageous turns is going in directions that won't fall back into the script, it does. It does. And everybody is elevated and we gorgeously kept each other on our toes. Because I love to improvise. Yes. Eddie loves to improvise. Uh-huh. And
he likes to improvise.
Huh? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, great.
And the thing that I love about Eddie Murphy is that I think I mentioned to you his innocence.
He's
an innocent.
He's like a little boy.
God bless him to have the world at his fingertips to choose projects. Uh-huh. But he's also a curious child, man, innocent.
Yeah.
And he's vulnerable. Uh-huh. And funny.
Good.
You know?
Who's this? The Brinks?
Who's that?
This is the Brinks.
That's my favorite shot from any film.
From the Brinks.
That's the Brinks job.
At the Boston, you did this in Boston?
We shot that all in the North End in the summer of 77. That's Peter Falk and I who played the two actual brother-in-laws that helped rob the Brinks vaults in the 50s, 1950, and Billy Friedkin directed it.
Uh-huh.
And it was a memorable film for me.
Tell me about Peter Falk. What a great actor. I love him. And you had fun with him?
And a good guy.
Is he?
Oh, just a wonderful guy. We just had a lot of good times in Boston, and we've remained friends 12, 13 years now.
Alan Green, I want to talk to you. Huh? Garfield, come on.
What?
You had Alan Garfield, you had another name, you
Gorowitz,
changed it.
My birth name.
You changed it, and then you went back to it again. Yeah. How come you changed it?
You know what's funny?
Come on, you changed it.
You know who influenced me in going back to it?
What?
The lady who was going to be here today, who couldn't be here,
Shelley Winters.
Do you know
that's
that? This is hysterical. My birth name, as you know, is Alan Gorowitz. When I became an actor, when I was a journalist, I became an actor, and because of the film that I told you about, Tomorrow the World, and the other film that influenced me was my favorite film to this day, which is Body and Soul, the Depression-era
Garfield. Garfield.
He played Charlie Davis, the boxer.
Right.
I know every line in the film.
Yeah.
I'm the only guy that does Lloyd Goff, who played Mr. Roberts, the boxing czar.
Yeah.
Remember Lloyd Goff in the film? I'd like to say goodnight to your mother, Charlie.
Yeah.
No more candy store for you, huh, Mrs. Davis?
That's right.
See, this way you get to fight for the championship right away, Charlie. And Joseph Pevney played Shorty.
Right.
And Canada Lee. Canada Lee. Bill Conrad.
Right. That's great.
Anyhow. So when I became an actor, I adopted the stage name of Alan Garfield in deference to Body and Soul and John Garfield. And from 65 to 77, those 12 years, it was Alan Garfield.
Yes.
My parents passed away in New Jersey.
And you changed it.
And I wanted to see the birth name up there for a few years. And for 5 years, I used Alan Gorowitz. The first film that I came out as Alan Gorowitz was The Brinks Job.
The Brinks.
And then The Stuntman.
Right.
And then about 5 years ago, after using Gorowitz for 5 years, Shelley Winter said to me, she says, you know something? You're at the top of your form as an actor and as a human being. She says, you've really evolved. Why don't you make life easy on yourself now that you've had your family name up there for five years? Why don't you go back to Garfield because it really suits you? Uh-huh. And I thought about it, and it was the seed that Shelley put in my mind, and I went back 5 years ago to Alan Garfield.